Good evening. As is very clear from the number of you crammed into the room, I think I'll also keep it short because tonight's guest needs very little introduction from me. He's the UK's most revered photojournalist and photographer, whose eyes have witnessed and whose camera has captured the worst atrocities committed by mankind over the past five decades. There's barely a conflict he hasn't covered, from Cyprus to Biafra, from the Bogside to Vietnam, all represented here in this room by some of his most powerful and iconic images of war and peace. For the past 40 years, he's developed his own therapy, returning from bloody chaos to these verdant Somerset coombs, where he lives today with his wife Catherine and youngest son Max. Blessed with such an abundance of stories and so many images that stand out, we've decided tonight to zoom in on six photographs which are on a piece of paper that you all have, photographs that Don has chosen, so he'll have to explain why, and he's going to talk us through setting the scene and explaining why they matter to him, and in between we'll talk a bit further, and then when I'm done with him, you'll all have your chance. So I wonder, Don, first of all, if we could talk about your first introduction to Somerset, which wasn't 40 years ago when you came to live here, but actually as a five-year-old child. You were brought up in North London in Finsbury Park, but you were evacuated during the war and found yourself in this place, which must have seemed quite incongruous.
Yes. I was 5 years of age, and I and a bunch of other children with the usual gas mask box, we all arrived at Frome Station, and we were selected. I mean, it could have been Auschwitz, you know, but it was Frome Station in my case, luckily.
Luckily,
me.
I should have said. Frome's not that bad.
I had a sister, and we were told not to. My mother said she didn't want to split up. I said, my sister and I were split up immediately. And she went to, we all lived in a little village you'll all be familiar with around here. It's called Knotts and Phillips. And I stayed for a year, and my sister stayed forever. And my mother gave her away to the people.
It was a reason, wasn't it?
Well, because they were well off, and we weren't well off, and my mother thought she'd have a better life. So I came back to London, and I never ever left the thoughts of Norton and Phillips out of my mind. It was, in those days, you know, we called it in between the wars, but of course the war is just kicking off, and Norton and Phillips is full of lazy streams and lazy-looking cows and primroses. It was all so idyllic from the place I originated from in North London, which was a bit of a dump, really. But even though I went back to North London, in a way, it was the very best thing that could have happened to me, because I grew up with rogues and tearaway boys who had no intentions of knuckling down at school. So that beginning, not unbeknown to me, when I came into this world that we're sitting here tonight with these photographs, I had a better understanding of pain and suffering and poverty and violence, most of all violence.
Well, we're going to slightly fast forward a bit because it is quite a long life. I don't want to rub it in. So we'll fast forward through some further tragic moments in your life. Your father died when you were 14. You had to finish any idea of education at that point and get a job. You worked a bit, then you did national service. You mentioned the sort of gangs that you were hanging around with in North London. And the first photograph that you've chosen is the first photograph in this exhibition tonight, The Governors, which was taken in 1958, or was it? Yes, it was, and published in 1958, which featured a North London gang that you were tenuously associated with, not quite a fully paid-up member of, but I think they were...
No, because I had a kind of mind that was split between not wanting to be incarcerated in a prison where most of these people wound up eventually, and secondly, I didn't know I was going to be a photographer, but I certainly knew I didn't want to be locked up in a prison, because I knew all about the prisons, which was always relayed back through the people who'd been and came back and boasted about it, and I thought, I want no part of that, really. But I have to be part of the violence that went on. You know, there was a lot of violence when I was a young boy, and I don't want to go into detail about it, but compared with the violence I eventually came up against, which is the violence on these walls tonight here, it was chicken feed, really.
But how did you come to be documenting them with a camera in the first place? Where did you get this camera, and why were you taking
it? I did my 2 years in the Air Force, and then towards the end of it, I was stationed in Nairobi. You see, that was wonderful, to be taken from Finsbury Park to this dump where I lived in, and in Nairobi, despite the fact there was a war on. But I was in the Air Force, and I actually failed my trade test to become a photographer. So when I left the Air Force, I came up with the same rank that I went in with. So I felt rather ashamed of... I couldn't read properly, you see, so I couldn't read the theory paper.
You were dyslexic?
Yes, I was dyslexic and also unwilling to learn. However, before I left the Air Force, the boys on my section, all we did was spend... all night long printing thousands of pictures of the jungle seen from the air, from an RAF jet that would go over. And it wasn't really what you call photography, it was surveillance and intelligence. So they said, you must buy a camera before you leave. So a pilot flew to Aden, which was a short distance away from Nairobi, and bought me this German Rolleicord camera for 30 quid, brand spanking new, in a wonderful leather box. It was my 30 quid, of course, but so I took it back to England with me, but basically I never did anything with it, so I thought I'd pawn it. So I pawned it. My mother took it down to the pawn shop. We got 5 quid for it. And my mother said, you know, you're really stupid. You really should get that camera out. So 5 quid appeared, and the camera came back to me. And then I started photographing these boys. And the picture in question, this bomb building picture, was taken at the end of the road where I lived in Finsbury Park. And I did this on a Sunday afternoon. The boys were all going to go to the cinema, but they never paid for the entrance. They always managed to get the back door of the fire exit door open and get in for nothing. And so they said, get that camera. So I said, yeah, okay, jump up there. And I took this picture. I didn't know that a few months later, these boys would be involved in a gang clash, because in those days, England was very tribal. You know, you wouldn't go to their area, they wouldn't come to your area. And the night I wasn't there, there was this clash, and the boys from the other tribe, you might say, came down, and they killed a policeman who tried to separate the two. And they killed them just on the other side of this bomb building, which was at the bottom of the street where I lived in North London.
And so you took this photograph and some others, and it seems kind of unbelievable today when you think how those giant media companies operate, but you took them into the Observer, you wandered in one day, and they said, yes, thank you, we'll have those.
Well, they said to me, the editor, in a quizzical way, swung his kind of swinging chair around and looked at me directly and said, did you take this photograph? I think he thought I was peddling it for somebody else. And I said, I did. And he said, would you consider doing some more? And I did. So I went off and did some more photographs, and I was arrested by the police. And they arrested me in a little cafe in Finsbury Park, and I came out of the cafe and the police car was there, and they said, get in this car. And when they invited you in to their cars in those days, you got in because you didn't want to, you know, be the receiving end of, you know, a refusal. So they would bash you one. So I've never been a lover of the police, really.
They're hard to find. Well, tell me a bit about that photograph, because actually, when you look at it now, I mean, it's certainly stood the test of time, hasn't it, when you think that it was really your debut, and also shows a remarkable eye for composition that must have been just entirely instinctive.
Well, to be honest, I won an art scholarship to go to a junior art school in London when I was 13 years of age, but when my father died, I went to the school for 1 year, but when my father died, I just had to go to work. So I worked on a steam train when I was 15, and I went through all the major west side of England on the London, Midland and Scottish region.
So you got to travel?
Well, it was free travel, but I worked harder for that 30 shillings a week. And so I went through all these great satanic cities in England, and I was 15 years of age. And when I got to the other end, I would wander the streets at night and go to music halls and see semi-nude shows.
That's really interesting, but not helpful in describing the photograph that we're trying to talk about. we can maybe talk about that later.
I'd like to make sure you do get the research right when I'm telling these stories. But the truth was that it was another experience of me travelling. And, you know, I've had an amazing life travelling. And so, to come back to this photograph, once it was published in The Observer, they gave me £50, and the McCullins never knew what £50 were in their lives.
You know, you were earning £10 a week, I think, at the time.
I was earning £10 a week in a studio in Berkeley Square.
Research.
and secondly, we never had a telephone in the house, so people tracked me down. I was offered every job in England on that Monday morning after the publication of this photograph. And basically, I knew very little about photography.
But you carried on, and the Governors appeared in 1958, and just 6 years later, from 1964 onwards, really, you were omnipresent, really, on battlefields, starting, as it seems, as the Berlin Wall went up. That was actually an assignment that you chose for yourself. They didn't want it at the paper, did they?
That's correct. I went to Paris. I saw a photograph of an East German soldier jumping into the West, and the actual soldier committed suicide a dozen years ago, strange enough. But that photograph inspired me, and I said to my wife at the time, would you mind if I went to Berlin? So when we went back to England, I bought my air ticket, and I rang the Observer and said, I'm going to Berlin. And they said, we're not interested. But they said, we will give you the name of the correspondent who's there. But it didn't matter. I went there, and I had 23 quid left in my pocket after the air ticket. And I was in Berlin looking at the building of the Berlin Wall in 1961. And I don't know why I was there. I don't know what made me go there. There was an instinctive kind of voice, which sounds as if, you know, when you hear those voices, you're a bit loony. But I knew I had to do this and go there. And it's been like that for the rest of my life. It's a judgment that comes from within me to say, you've got to do this.
That led you from to Cyprus, I think, first of all, and then from there, Congo, Vietnam, Cambodia, and then what was known as Biafra. So what first took you to war, and what kept you going in terms of doing that? I mean, there's a description in this book of when you were in Cyprus, and you ended up taking an amazing photograph that's here somewhere
down
of
here,
the soldier
running
down the street. But that was because you decided to take someone on a little tour around your old kind of neighborhood in Nicosia.
Well, what happened was I was stationed in Cyprus for the last part of my national service, 6 months. And I was actually, strange enough, it's another coincidence, I was stationed right next to the Temple of Apollo, right on the seashore. So we were on under tented quarters, but I mean, the Temple of Apollo right next to me, there is some photos here, a couple of the Temple of Bel, which ISIS have just blown up. Mm. So, you know, I feel as if I'm either following events or they're following me, I don't know. I'm in Cyprus, I have this man from the Observer newspaper, but he was the ecclesiastical correspondent.
Slightly in deep water.
Once the gunfire started, he said, I have a dinner appointment in Nicosia. Is there any way we could get out of here? And I said, OK, I'll try and get us out, because I was driving the car. There's all this battle going on. I got him out, and then I drove back in, and I was pounced upon by the Turkish police. And they put me in a cell for the night. And when I woke up in the morning, a bullet hit the bars in the cell. They didn't lock the door. I was a guest, you see. So, and then I thought, I was so excited. I thought, the battle is still going to go on. This is my big chance. So I came out of that cell, and then I started seeing what was going on around me. And this was my, what you might say, baptism of war, really. And I knew that I could handle it. I thought, this is where you belong.
But why? What were you feeling? Because a lot of people, that baptism, as it were, would have put them off for life. Perhaps saner people might have decided that was not the best route to be taking. But literally, you went from there into some of the bloodiest battles, you know, in our lifetimes.
I reckon I was meant to do it. Because once I started doing it, I mean, there are some photos here of a woman whose husband had been murdered, and you see her, she's lying on the floor cradling this man. They'd only been married a week, and all their wedding presents were in the room behind me, and they'd been systematically smashed by people's rifles. It was, you know, these are Greek against Turks, and they used to reverse the killing. You know, someone would go out and shoot a shepherd, the most wonderful people in the world, and then the other side would go out and shoot another shepherd, you know. And it was so awful. And I wasn't the most kind of educated, minded intellectual person at all ever, but I had a different side to me that often intellectual people don't have. And I thought, I felt like a human being. I could feel a human response, where other people try to work it out up here, you know. So.
But what was driving you initially? I mean, were you politically minded? Were you a truth seeker? Or were you simply a young man who'd found a kind of glamour and excitement and a vocation in the theatre of war?
What did you say, glamour?
Well, you know, it was exciting. It was probably a lot more exciting than, you know, going to your job in Mayfair.
Of course it was, but I could understand what you mean by glamour. You mean the glamour means me having this a dashing life and doing this and getting on aeroplanes, and it all seems a bit Hollywood, you know. But behind it all, the motivation was driven, A, by photography, and you mentioned the political side of things. I didn't have the brain power that early on in my life to understand the politics. You picked it up as you went along, and you chose your sides. Now, basically, you have to be incredibly objective normally when you work on a newspaper, but, you know, there's always some bias in even the people we read today. So I tended to take the side of the underdog, really.
And did your motivation change? I mean, did it change from, you know, in Cyprus, just that instinctive feeling that you were in the right place and you were doing the thing you were meant to do? How did that change? How did that evolve?
I just thought to myself, something's not right here. You know, you can't just kick a door in and murder all the male members in that room. I mean, the Cyprus stuff was only the beginning it was the vanguard of something more awful to come in my life. When you go to a great big war like Vietnam, you're in a huge machinery of war. It's much bigger, more tidal, you know. These gun battles in Cyprus were village affairs, and they were still as equally as bad and awful. But there are very many layers of war that I've seen in my life. And just when I thought I'd seen it all, you know, along comes the ISIS crowd.
You said that your photographs were taken as propaganda. You know, you were saying something with them, obviously. Were you hopeful to change the world at that point?
Naively, you know, I had to try and put upon myself my image of what I was doing. I had to have some. There had to be some recompenses. What is he doing? What's he up to? What's he thinking? So I thought, yes, maybe these pictures could, you know, upset people's thinking and, you know, do something about it. But it was incredibly naive of me to think that, because I, after all these years, I frankly feel that I'm, you know, like you can preach to the converted, but I have a funny suspicion I may have failed my own thinking about this whole thing.
That must be quite a depressing thing to think.
It is depressing, really, because, you know, the wars I covered were bad enough, and when the wars in Sierra Leone came along and, you know, mad, crazed boys of 14 were chopping off children's arms, and then you had Rwanda, then, you know, has it ever stopped in the last 5,000 years? I doubt it, really.
You haven't... I gave you a choice to pick six, well, in fact, it was five, but we've ended up with six photographs, and you didn't choose a war photograph, which is probably telling in itself why.
I didn't choose them all, did I? Okay, maybe it's because I'm a bit cantankerous occasionally. The second picture I chose, if I can talk about it, is possibly the worst picture I've ever taken in my life.
No, you've got to tell me first why you didn't choose a war photograph. Because I think that the photograph about to talk about is slightly different in that way.
Okay, the troubles of war photographs is that they can be, as you said earlier, if I can slightly renege on my criticism, that it can be glamorous war, but it can only be glamorous if you're doing it from a Hollywood point of view. It can be beautiful war, and I'm really sticking my neck out saying this, because people would say, hang on a minute, how can a war be beautiful? I don't mean it in that context. What I mean is the actions of others. You know, I've seen men cradling dying men, and I've seen white men and black men crying over each other's deaths. You know, they call them medics, and I've seen men crying before they've been executed in front of me, thinking I can they plead with their eyes and look at me and think, well, he hasn't got a gun, he's got a camera, maybe he can help me. And, you know, I've had to carry the yoke of this on my shoulder as mine. It's all there still. So how do you decipher glamour, excitement, you know, and the whole thing? It is exciting war, and it also became a slightly druggy thing to many of us, not just me alone.
I'm going to tweet a bit and bring up one of your war photographs, this one actually behind my head, which is just coincidental, just because I think it's one of the only photographs, maybe the only photograph. This is a dead North Vietnamese soldier and his plundered belongings, I think it's called. And you came across this body and some American soldiers rifling through his pockets, and you reset the scene.
I do.
Which is something that I think you would be entirely against generally in terms of...
Absolutely.
So what was different about this situation, and why did you do that, and why would you be absolutely against it philosophically?
The irony is the situation was I was sleeping under a table for a couple of weeks, and one day I went out the door of this destroyed house another way and realized that he and I had been sleeping just partitioned by this corrugated iron. And some American soldiers were behind me, and they saw him, and they were looking for souvenirs, which I always think is a big taboo in one's life. So they rifled around his stuff, and they found his contents of his bag, and they were throwing them down and laughing, calling him a gook. And these are the guys I've been hanging out with for 2 weeks in this enormous battle that was killing them, these Americans in great numbers every day. And I thought, this is not right, really. You know, this man can only be about 18 years of age. And, you know, he'd been lying in the rain because it'd been raining all day. And I thought, this is not right. And when he went away and I saw these humble possessions, and I thought, he can't talk, I'm going to talk for him. And I scooped them together. I knew it was, you know, a really pretentious thing I was doing, but I didn't think it was the ultimate crime. I became his voice. And a few months ago, well, last year, I met some North Vietnamese photographers, very brave people, because they came up against enormous American firepower, which I wouldn't want to go against. And they saw this picture, and they were all photographing it. And they said, we will find this man through these photos. We will find his parents. Because I don't know if you're aware of it, but if you come from that part of the world, your spirit is forever lost and roaming out there, unless it's found and put to bed, so to speak. So if you have a son or a relative who's been lost in the war, you know that that loss is not just yours. It's the whole family thing about finding the spirit.
And it's not
so I thought that, you know, by doing that, I couldn't keep him alive, but I was trying to keep his voice alive, which he, you know, he was gone, that man. And I look at that picture, and people always bring it up about, why did you do this? Is it the right thing to do? I thought it was, really.
Let's talk about the photograph that you tried to fast forward to, which is the photograph of the 9-year-old albino boy with his empty tin of corned beef in Biafra, which you took in 1968.
Yes.
And it's a photograph I can't look at, because every time I do, I cry. Why did you choose it?
Well, because what you just said was meant, that's why I did it, I wanted you to cry.
Thank you.
I wanted you to cry. I want everybody to cry when they look at it. I wanted you to say, first of all, you wouldn't understand the circumstances of an albino boy born in Africa. You're born right away with a huge problem. I mean, even today they're being persecuted and murdered because they're looked upon as evil spirits or evil people. So this boy, who, as you can see, is barely standing on those legs, and he would never have survived, this boy. As soon as I walked into the camp, he put his eye on me, and I thought, don't look at him. I thought, no, don't look at him, whatever you do. So I tried to look elsewhere, but I could feel him burning through me. And in a way, it was good I could, because it made me feel, you know, I was doing my job as I was trying to see this appalling tragedy. There were 800 children dying in this hospital. It wasn't a hospital, it was an old school. And so I went away and spoke to one of the French doctors who was from Médecins Frontières, and while I was talking to him, this boy grabbed hold of my hand. And I thought, if this boy doesn't go away, I think I might weep. And I really thought, you know, why is he picking on me? And it was a terrible thoughts to have, really, because I had children of my own at the time.
He said that from the beginning, you know, you understood that you couldn't intervene, you could only record, really, but that actually gradually you changed your mind about that, and you felt that you could in those moments do something, or you could try to.
Occasionally I would pick up somebody who couldn't run. I picked an old lady up once in a gun battle in Cyprus, and I was very young. I was about 26, and I was strong, and I just scooped this old lady up. She was a really old Turkish lady, and all the bullets came in, and this, and the British soldier was trying to help her down the road, and I thought, if he doesn't move, she's going to be dead. So I went and got hold of her, and it was like carrying a rag doll. She weighed nothing, and I felt really good about it. I thought, but you see, that's where you start cross-purposing, and you say, hang on a minute, what are you here for? You can't do this all the time. You won't get any pictures, or you won't do this and that. So, you know, you can't be all things to all men, really.
Judging by even this small collection of your work, because bear in mind, for every image that's on this wall, there are hundreds and hundreds more. You witnessed an awful lot of man's depravity in the decade between 1964 and 74, and I wondered what that did to your normal life, if you had a normal life.
You came back from these wars, and you went back to a house that was run by a wife who was also the man of the house, and had to fix things that went wrong electrically or do some other thing. And I had my first son fell off the table at one occasion, knocked himself out, and on a second occasion he swallowed a rubber sucker, and he nearly died on the kitchen floor. Luckily, we lived in a street full of doctors, and they all rushed in, and they were going to do a tracheotomy, and they somehow managed to save this boy dying. So, you know, there am I talking about myself all the time, but there was a person, a wonderful woman who was there, you know, basically running the show. So, but when you came back, I remember once I went to a war in Cambodia and I got injured, and she met me at London Airport, and she said, "Get in that car, you silly bugger." She was so cross with me, and I look back on that, you know, in a way, and I think she could have said something worse to me. So, you know, it wasn't easy for both parties, the wife and in a marriage, can you imagine? So it was, I was then beginning to walk a very fine line, which I was always afraid of falling from.
Let's talk about your next photograph, which is of a 24-year-old, rather unbelievably, a 24-year-old mother and child awaiting death in Biafra, as you've captioned it. Why did you choose this photograph? There's something biblical about it.
It's biblical, and it's also slightly iconic, really. That may be due to the lighting, might be due to my composition. I mean, let's not forget, I really care about my photography. I don't just kick doors in and get in and take pictures like some kind of thug, you know. I'm a great, really sensitive person when I'm in these places, you know.
Doesn't that feel like a dichotomy in that situation as well, to be thinking about how to frame it and how to make it right at the same time as you're dealing with something so, you know, immensely tragic?
Well, it also brings to mind when I was a child, when the war ended in England, I was 10, and then when I was about 15, publications came out about the Holocaust. And you looked at these pictures and you think, no, I can't look at those pictures. And I think I'm being slightly artful by thinking, if I compose these pictures in a beautiful way, as tragic as they are, I can hold you, I can make you look, I can make you respond and try to get an ounce of understanding and sympathy from you. So there are two ways of looking at this. You know, you can't make ugly, atrocious things like that look beautiful, because it wouldn't be the right thing to do. But on the other hand, I don't want you to be rejected right away.
How important is the process for you, you know, from the shutter to the emerging ghosts that come out on the pages when you're in your dark room? You know, is realizing the full potential of your photograph something that doesn't happen in that moment? It happens in the whole process all the way through.
It's a journey, really. You see these things. The night I took that picture, I went back and I was sleeping in a missionary with a very nice man called Leonard Cheshire. He was a great war hero. And he kept looking at me in a strange way, and he was a very, very religious man. I personally have have pushed religion back from me because of the loss of my father. I was angry about it. But can I just go back to this picture again? Because there was something about that picture, that 24-year-old mother who looks like a 64-year-old grandmother. I was looking whilst I was photographing her, that in the background I could see some scribbling on the wall. And these people were very religious. They were Christian Igbos. And when I thought, when I finished this picture, I only took a couple of frames. I don't, you know, machine gun people with all my photography. I do it very delicately and carefully and thoughtfully. And I thought, what I'm going to do when I finish this, I'm going to go down, I want to know what that writing says. And I went down the back, and on the wall somebody had written, today I was reborn. And the mere fact that I can remember this after nearly 50 years means that, you know, it kind of stayed with me. There are things that stay with me, things that other people would wish they wouldn't stay with you.
Well, I did want to ask, because, you know, just even looking around the exhibition, you go home and those images stay with you for a period of time, and to have lived through each and every one of them. Do you like being left alone, or do you find being alone an uncomfortable experience because they're all living with you all the time?
Oh, some people said to me, oh, you must have had the most terrible nightmares. And I said, yeah, mine often happen in the daytime when I'm on a bus or on a train or I'm driving. You know, I have a really good recall. If I had the same recall, you know, from my dyslexia, if I could get rid of that, I would win all kinds of Nobel Peace Prizes for literature. But I do have an extraordinary recall for photography. I even know the exposures on these pictures I took donkeys years ago. So, and then I have a darkroom, remember, which is like a kind of mausoleum. You go in there, you shut the door, and you can bring all this back to you again. You can relive the whole thing again. The one picture I don't print anymore is this picture of the albino boy.
Why?
Well, because to see that boy coming through to you in the developer, it's as if he's saying, oh, hi, I'm still here. You know, it's really, sounds a bit kind of far-fetched, but if I didn't have an imaginative feeling and a strong will and all kinds of other things, I don't think I could have put all this stuff together. And may I just say, I could put 500 of these pictures on the wall here. It wouldn't be necessary, and there wasn't the space.
Do you think that still, you know, the amazing thing about, one of the amazing things about these photographs is that there are moments of stillness in which you engage with the subject, with the person in the photograph. I think it was it Robert Capa, I'm going to paraphrase, who said that there's no such thing as a bad photograph, it's just the distance, you know, the closeness you are to your subject. And that's been one of the sort of hallmarks of your photographs all the way through, is that there is no distance between you and the subject. That must be very difficult in those situations.
Can I just say right away that photographers, and I'm one of them, all of us, we do not have the right to do this work. We have to do it by consent, and you edge closer and closer and closer. And, you know, I've got away with it for some extraordinary reason. Not totally, because one day I really got a good punching from a woman.
Did you?
It was a terrible story, because she came around the corner in Beirut and saw her apartment block flattened with her family in it. And I went bang, took the picture, and I thought, oh dear, look out, it's going to come. And she came roaring over and started punching me, and I deserved it, really. And I was so upset about it, I went back to the hotel. I had to get through hordes of Palestinians who were pointing guns at me or trying to rip my camera, and it was just a terrible, terrible day, which I was part of that day, but I made that foolish mistake. And so I went back to the hotel, and I was really shaking, and I said to him, cup of coffee, please, cup of coffee. And then a guy bounced in and said, hey, Don. I said, no, don't leave me alone. He said, no, I've got to tell you. He said, a car bomb's gone off and killed that woman that punched you. So I thought, you know, is there any way that I can hide? Is there any way I can not feel to blame? The woman was talking to finally with an interpreter to a journalist after the calming of that moment after me. And another car bomb went off, and she was standing in the street, and the journalist was in a doorway, and it swept her completely away and killed her. So you have to be reasonably strong to get through such a day. And I did a book once, and it was called The Uncertain Day. It wasn't a book, it was a carousel of pictures. But every day was very uncertain.
Do you think, recently we had that photograph of that five-year-old boy washed up on the beach in Turkey, the Syrian migrant refugee. And it seemed in that moment, all of a sudden, that a single image still has the power to change people's perceptions and to move us. But in a world where we're so dazzled by imagery now, which has changed dramatically from when you first started out taking photographs, do you think that those moments are rarer?
Before you even finished your sentence, I knew you were going to talk about that photograph.
You know me
I knew you well. I knew that photograph would change minds. It shifted all kinds of hostile opinions, even in many of us. That picture was an amazing picture. The little dangling legs and the little sodden shoes. It was an astonishing tragedy, and we saw that picture, and people had a totally different opinion about the struggle of these people. But of course, the situation has certainly gone away in another direction. It still is bad. The papers are full of. There was another dead child today, which I never miss a trick. I never miss any of these images. These images will come and go, just as the image of the girl running down the road in Vietnam with her back on fire. It blew everybody's mind away, and they thought, this is it, it's terrible. But we eventually see more and more of these, and we eventually forget, which is rather sad.
Why have you stuck to black and white?
Because we live in a world that's full of colour. I know all the spectrum, the seven colours of the spectrum. It's all around us, colour. I do shoot a lot of colour, strange enough, but I don't have any interest in it. I think the black and white really is like it really hits you when you look at it. It's not a gimmick, but I print all these pictures, and I tend to go darker and darker, and obviously it's my darkness coming out in these prints.
Can we go to the next photograph, which I think is the fourth photograph, and it's actually back in Britain after a lot of these really horrific wartime experiences, and instead of doing a nice job, you decide to go to the north of England and you start photographing people in deprivation. And this photograph, Mealtime for the Children, which is cooked on a camping stove. Why?
I'll tell you why, because when I kept getting on aeroplanes. I kept going to other countries, and I just started to lose my identity. I thought, so who am I? Where do you come from? Who do you belong to? Do I belong to, publishing companies or this or that? Who am I? And I thought, I'm going to branch out, and I did a book called Homecoming. And you can't imagine how many loony people live in this country.
No, I think I can.
I had such joy to... I remember driving down the road one day. I'll come back to this picture, but I remember driving down the road one day and I saw a big notice saying, Connie Walker's Cat's Home. So I swung the car straight into the driveway and I thought, you've got to do this one. So I knocked on the door and Connie Walker came out and she said, can I help you? And I said, I was just wondering if I could shoot pictures. She said, get off my property. And I was so shamefaced and embarrassed, but I was laughing at the same time. I've never heard of a name called Wagga before. So anyway, coming back to this picture.
Yes, please.
I was exploring England, and I went to Bradford. And the moment I got to Bradford, it was the most extraordinary place I've ever been to. And because I've never seen such poverty. And I would walk around the streets, and these people would say, come in this house and see how we're expected to live. And this woman called Doreen, whose husband was in prison, she was actually cooking the supper for these children on one of those little French gas stoves because she didn't have any money for the electricity and the gas stove. So, these children, I saw children like that where I grew up as a boy. I grew up in those kind of circumstances. And I didn't think that in the mid-70s that people in England would be living like this. Because when you go to the third world, and they sometimes question you about England. They say, oh, there's no poor people in England. I said, I know there's a million poor people living in this country, and it hasn't got any better. I could go back to Bradford now and find people just like it. I can guarantee it.
Alongside the work you're most famous for, you've also made some incredible journeys with some incredible writers, people like Bruce Chatwin, Eric Newby, Norman Lewis, Mark Shand, your sadly demised friend. How did those collaborations work? And were they, you know, buddies enjoying documenting an adventure together, or was there something more closely entwined?
Is this twinge, this question, with your curiosity about how did I get on with him?
Yes, both. No, and also because I think that you felt for a very long time perhaps intellectually insecure because of your dyslexia, because of your upbringing, because you felt that you hadn't been able to embrace the things that you were perhaps interested in, but not literature and so on. And yet here you were, with some of the greatest writers of their time.
Well, I think I was very fortunate, really, because they became my tutors, really, and they helped. I mean, I traveled with a wonderful man called Norman Lewis, and I doubt there are anyone in this room who would know who he was. He's been dead quite a long time. I know you know him. But we were going through the jungle one day, where we were driving through the equatorial forest in Honduras, and he said, look out there, see those orchids growing in that tree? And I said, oh. He said, there must be 1,000 quids of the orchids up there. And I was laughing, really. And then he said to me one day, he said, you know, you taught me how to see things. I said, rubbish. Great writers could see just as well as any photographer I know, even any famous photographer I know. If you can't see as a writer, you wouldn't. But, you know, I was very privileged to be with the people who had the education I wasn't fortunate enough to have. So, in a way, I wasn't going to waste time, you know, with this opportunity. I was going to get as much out of them as I could, really.
And what were those adventures like Iron Jaya and so on? You'd already travelled everywhere and seen a lot. What were you looking for there?
Well, we found a river which was called the Kolof, which is a Dutch-German name. And the sea around us was called the Afura Sea. And it's even darker than that river that runs through your house. And it was a very famous area because Nelson Rockefeller's son disappeared in the early 60s. He was with a man from the museum up in Massachusetts, an anthropologist, and they were in a boat that was going out to sea. They were being sucked out to sea. So Rockefeller swam ashore with some flotation around him, and they're never sure whether he got ashore or was eaten by sharks or he was cannibalized in this village called Oceanette. And we went to this village and we saw these people, I mean, and we were scared to death of these people. I mean, they were terribly skinny, and they had an illness, which is slightly confusing, because it's called ambrosia, and you think it's the rice pudding you buy in a tin. It's basically because of their lack of vitamins that their skin is literally flaking off. And there were crocodiles in the river, and the man we were with, one of the police guys, we shot the crocodile, and the boys roasted and ate it, and it stank like hell. And so, I mean, this little boy from Finsbury Park and Norton St. Phillips suddenly was in the most privileged position, and I was learning. I was learning things that you would never have an opportunity to learn, even in Somerset, I might add. So I felt, in a way, I felt a bit shortchanged as a child, losing my father, not having an education, and growing up in that slum where I lived. But I've made up for it since. I've learned as much as I can. I'm back on the reading course, and I'm an incredibly lucky man, really.
You've also had a bit of an eye for the ladies over the years, I think it's fair to say.
You missed one.
And no, I haven't. I've jumped because they were in the wrong order, because I always wanted her first. And one of the photographs you've chosen is Aphrodite, no surprise, found in the Hadrianic baths of Leptis Magna in Tripoli Castle Museum in Tripoli. Why did you choose this photograph?
Because it's on the wall over there, and I think it's one of the most beautiful things I've ever done, really. I stood in the museum with my camera. You're not allowed to put tripods up in case you use the tripods to damage things. That's the museum rules these days. So I just stood and I took a deep breath and a 15th of a second, and I photographed this thing. I think it's incredibly beautiful, this. I've looked at a lot of ugliness in my life, you know, and I'm not incapable of looking at beauty as well. I mean, it's time for me to start looking at the beautiful things, really.
You're not very good at taking holiday snaps, though, are you?
I've got a very bad family record of taking pictures on holiday.
Is that because your relationship with your camera is a very defined one, and you find it hard to have a different role with it?
Yeah, if I go on holiday, I don't really feel as if I've got a who keeps snapping away. And I also think, you know, children don't like being snapped at all the time with a camera. If they're on holiday, they just don't want to be told, oh, stay there for a minute, stay there. You know, they don't want it. I just don't do it. It's not in me to do it, really.
You've had triple, or is it quadruple, heart surgery in recent years, and trouble with the foot that makes scarpering when you're in trouble at speed an issue. Yet against the advice of almost everyone who loves you, would you like to tell us all where you celebrated your 80th birthday?
Yes, I was in Iraq. not a very joyful place to be. But I still have curiosity, you see. You don't just have curiosity and then say, right, it's time to, you know, like the alarm clock, you switch it off. It doesn't just go like that. It's not that simple. I still have curiosity. You know, it's like that theory of mine that you walk along the beach in Cornwall or any beach and you're dying to turn those stones over to see if there's a baby crab there or some life there, you know. It's in me to turn stones over in my life and see if there is other life. And I mustn't give up, really. It's what makes me get to this age and go on. And I still process film. I was in my dark room yesterday and today. I'm never going to stop doing it, even though I keep threatening to.
You've seen the worst of human nature. I wonder if you also feel that you've seen the best, if one opens your eye to the other in a way that it might not have been otherwise.
There's another book of mine coming out, and there's a picture that's never been processed, but it's a picture of an English nurse, doctor, I beg your pardon, holding one child in her arm, and another child standing in front of her. They're all dying, all of them. One's standing barely, and there's a saline drip going into another one. And I thought, you know, if there were more people like this in the world, it would be a much more beautiful place to live in. There are such people. I've seen lots of them, really. And it's as wise as I'm always looking at a man with a Kalashnikov, you know, threatening. I was in Syria a couple of years ago, and a man was coming up the road, and he was a fundamentalist, and I put my camera up. It was a second mistake in my life. I thought, no, don't do it. So I took it down, and he came skidding up to me like that. He said, started screaming and shouting. I said, why don't you go away? And the man next to him had the Kalashnikov in front of me. And I thought, I've never let anybody talk to me like that. But the odds were against me.
Yes, definitely. I'm glad you realised that.
Took a long time to penny to drop. Anyway, I really like, as you haven't mentioned it yet, I hope you're going to come to it, but I really like photographing the landscape.
Well, you've just mentioned it, so let's talk about it, because your final photograph is just around the corner from here, a view that we're lucky enough to look at every day. They're not always as splendid as that in this rainy winter. Batcombe Vale.
Well, I think these landscapes, Somerset's been a very strange county. It's always been beautiful to me, but people have always gone through this county to go on their holiday to Devon and Cornwall. So luckily for us, we've got it to ourselves. The secret is out of the hat, I'm afraid not. That's the trouble. Anyway, I go and do these landscapes, and a couple of years ago, I stood in a field looking at a dew pond, which is near where I live, and the man who owned it, who's been carted away because he's gone a bit loony, he came up to me and he owned the land and he said, why are you looking at that pond? I said, because it's beautiful. And he said, I don't see it. And I said, no, you wouldn't. and he didn't get it. He didn't get it. I was being cheeky. But and then another time I was in a field just north of Evercreech and I was standing there, and sometimes I wait there 2 or 3 hours. And it's wonderful, really. Because, you know, if you want meditation, you're watching the clouds and the thing, and it's one. And then I saw a man, and he was coming all around the hedgerows. I thought, oh my God, he's going to come and
ruin my picture,
speak to me, ask me what I'm doing. And he had a big, strange Australian kind of outback hat on and a Jack Russell. And he was going all around the hedgerows, and then he got right to me, and he went right past me and never said a word.
Were you bereft?
No, but he went all the way down, and then he came all the way back down the park and never said a word and went. And I enjoyed that day. And it reminds me of something. I was on an aeroplane once, without dropping names, and I'm going to do it anyway. I was on an aeroplane. I sat next to Alec Guinness, and we both had aisle seats. And he was reading, and I was sitting here looking at something. And a friend of his who I knew, I said, oh, by the way, I saw a friend of yours on the plane. And I said, I didn't say anything to him. And he said, he would have thanked you for it. and I just thought, humanity does occasionally make me laugh, like that man in Evercreek. So standing there is my reward, whether I get a photograph or not, it doesn't bother me.
Is it your reward for everything? Is it what obliterates the other images that you say you have unfortunately got such a strong recall for?
I think what it does, it brings back some dignity for me, really. I'm not proud of these ugly pictures on the wall, but what I'm actually trying to say is that by the time I leave this earth, I want people to say, well, he wasn't a bad guy. You know, I didn't create this. Only visually I've created it. I didn't harm any of these people. And I don't want to see the English countryside harm. The English countryside has a bit of a crusade behind it for me because, you know, more and more people are needing houses. But the big houses that are going up around here, they're not the people who need them. And when they go up, I think, oh, God, you know, there's more light coming. I like these dark evenings when, you know, it's all dark at night and proper. Mm. I don't like sodium lights and cities springing up around me. So I'm constantly, I feel rather fragile and insecure about the countryside as much as I do about the outside world and the tragedies.
Just finally, because now it's time for everyone in the audience to have an opportunity to talk to you. You do fight against the description of yourself as an artist, yet here you are hanging very comfortably in this gorgeous gallery space and about to release a limited edition and rather extraordinary art book, which is featuring your collected work in three volumes called Irreconcilable Truths. So why do you rail against the idea of yourself being an artist? And isn't it a sort of second life for these images, long after they've fulfilled the duty of their inception, which is to make us sit up and take note? Then they become something other.
I know there's hypocrisy ringing its bell above me. I know that you say, well, if you're, I'm not an artist. I'm a photographer who happens to be reasonably good at composing my pictures. I've looked at the work of other people. I've studied the great people in my life before me, wonderful people. I've studied photography a hell of a lot. I've got a great library. You know, I've got to do it right. You know, I don't want to mess about here. I've got to do it right. And but I don't need the title of artist because I'm a photographer. It suits me fine. That's the first answer to your question.
What is there another one?
No,
I think that'll do me fine. That was perfect. And it was also a beautiful conclusion, actually.
Oh, yes, there was another thing. You were getting that.
I'm trying to end it neatly, narrative. No chance.
It's not going to be that easy for you, really. I actually want to say that I don't want to keep these photographs. I've got 5,000 pictures in my house and 60,000 negatives.
Honestly, there's a lot of people in this room who'd gladly help you out and take some away with them.
What I'm getting at is that they're almost imprisoned in my house. I want to release them like doves, if you like, for a corny old phrase. I want them to be seen and keep giving them a new life, because new life means new disciples. I'm not going to convert everybody in this world, but people are going to come along and they're going to look at them and it's going to make them think and do something. They might become a doctor, they might become somebody involved in charities or something like that. So by springing them out, and this is an art centre, I can be accused of saying, well, what kind of standards are you? You're not an artist, but you don't like, you know, this, that and the other. So I've got to get the space when it's offered to me.
Thank you very much. It wasn't as good an ending as the one before, but it'll have to do. We'd love to have some questions from the floor. Oh, no. Sorry, the very first question is coming from my husband.
Oh, it's
he's very eager.
Yeah, I've got an issue with Don.
Have you?
Yeah, and I want to get it out now.
Yeah.
So in the summer, when we were in our dinghy...
Stand up.
I'm not standing up, no.
Okay. I can hear it.
When we were in our dinghy...
Speak clearly.
I'll try. You were really quick to tell me what I was doing wrong, what I should be doing, etc., etc. You wanted to teach me, but you were rubbish, actually. But when it comes, I've got a camera, you never instinctively say, oh, do this, do that, or why don't you try that? And what I don't get is you've got all of this product, loads of it, 60,000 or whatever, but you don't have the thing on your methodology. Why isn't there a Don McCullin Academy? Why do you not want to teach and take on to new people?
Why aren't you teaching the next generation how to take photographs? I'll paraphrase the gentleman over there.
I thought the question was going to be worse than that.
I don't know where he was going with the dinghy and the whole thing. But
I think there are teachers and people who can't teach and can do the job. You know, I'm one of them. I've tried teaching once, and I was invited to go to a school called Vevey in Switzerland. And they were the laziest students I've ever seen in my life. They were mocking me, really. And I said, we're all going to go different places in town today. I want you to go out and photograph. And they came back, and they didn't go. They simply didn't go. And I thought, why am I doing this? These people are mocking me. And I vowed never to do it. I've never done it again.
And you stuck
it's
to it.
It's not in me to... I'm sure that's not satisfactory for him.
Well, no, I think he's hoping that you'll go over to the house maybe tomorrow or something and give him a little how-to. Another question, preferably from someone not related to me. Thank you, Jason. Thank you, gentlemen, back in the row there.
I just wondered if you could go back in time to 1958 and give yourself a piece of advice, knowing what you know now, about for your future professional career, what that piece of advice would be.
If you go back to 1958,
yeah.
If you could give yourself a piece of professional advice, knowing what you do now, what would you be saying to the young Don McCullin?
Do you know the funny thing is I don't think I would have any other opinions. I the way I got along in life, I did it in a very humble way. The day I took that photograph, I never even owned an exposure meter. The negative is perfectly exposed. It was, in the old days, photographers prided themselves on judging the light, which is a bit conceited. But I just simply didn't have the money to buy an exposure meter. And I took that picture, I didn't think it was going to go anywhere. I thought it was just to please those boys, you know.
So would you still have gone everywhere, done everything?
No, because I think if those boys hadn't have been involved in the gang, the murder of the policeman, things like that, I wouldn't have afterwards flourished through the knowledge of that photograph. So I was still very naive in those days, and I still did, God knows what I would have done with my life. I don't think... If I hadn't gone into photography, I don't know what I would have done with my life. It would have been miserable.
And have you learned anything that's made you wiser that is specific?
I've learned a hell of a lot in the last 60 years. I've taught myself everything in photography. I've made all these thousands of prints, and I've had exhibitions all in major cities all over the world, and I've got exhibitions coming down the line. So I don't really think I made any mistakes by not thinking in other directions. I think I kept myself in truly, you know, I didn't get big-headed. I let praise run off of my shoulders like a duck's feathers. I just focus on being or going in the direction I've made up my mind I've been going in.
Well, that's quite a satisfying thing to be able to say. There's very few of us who could probably say that. Another question from the floor. There's a gentleman right there at the end of the row.
Is today a golden age of the image with everybody being able to take a photograph and publish it, or is there too much freedom, and how do you feel about with the internet and how everybody can upload an image immediately, and therefore there is the child that was picked up on the beach, that image was all around the world within hours. Whereas before, your photos had to go through a process, they had to be edited, and that. How do you feel about the way the image is controlled now?
So are we in a sort of golden age for the image because of the access that people have? Because you can take a picture, I can take a picture of something happening right in front of my eyes and have it halfway around the world in 2 minutes. Is that an improvement? Has that made things better? Or is it actually detrimental to...
It's very interesting. Yeah, it's a very interesting question. And first of all, let me apologize. I can't hear very well. The thing is that we've got more communication and access to communication than we've ever had in our lives. And I don't really think it's... I don't know. Is it a massive improvement? It's great for booking airline tickets and things like that. I personally don't switch a computer on. I don't know how to do it. I'm going to stay with my photography.
That's why you've had to thank Catherine, your wife, in this book.
I'm going to stay with
somebody has to switch it on.
Yeah, well, otherwise I don't go on holiday, you see. So I think, really, it's a wonderful question, really, because communication is so extraordinary. I've been to India recently, and even the man who was driving me from A to B and the fishermen on the beach were talking on the phone. It's extraordinary, really. But has it made... has it improved our lives? Of course it does if you're broken down on the highway and you want to get a breakdown car to you, and, you know, this, that, and the other. But I don't know, visually, I see trash in the newspapers all the time. You know, I rushed to get my paper today and I thought it was full of trash. And there was a tragic picture of the Turkish soldier once again holding another dead child. But there's not a lot of information visually that... It's all about celebrity now, really.
Anyone else? We've got time for one or two more questions. This lady here. Pass the microphone.
Looking at your... A lot of these pictures, I understand that you're bearing witness. You're bearing witness to the tragedy that you're watching, and you're arresting what is an ugly component of humanity. There were two pictures that really troubled me, because it seemed to me that most of your pictures, you're observing and you're active in the way that you capture that image, that you bear witness. The two pictures that really troubled me were these ones of the guns being pointed at these young men, and I wondered, how did your presence affect the event itself? Did that happen because you were there at that moment?
Another good question, in my opinion, because I arrived on the scene, and I don't think for a second that what you're saying it doesn't have some substance. I think once I turned up, these guys, the Belgium gendarmerie, not Belgium, these are Congolese gendarmerie, and they're notoriously vicious people. And they were already shooting these boys and killing them and kicking them into the river. I was by a great river called the Lualaba. It joins the Congo. And this is in Stanleyville. And I arrived there. I was forbidden to be there by it was 1,000 kilometers from Leopoldville, it was called in those days. And I got there on a CIA plane in a mercenary uniform, which I was colluding with a mercenary guy to get me the uniform, to get me there. I was risking my neck to get there. And I came upon this scene. And then I had my camera and I brought it out. And then some soldiers came up and said, mercenary soldiers said, "What are you doing? Who are you? Where have you been to?" And I said, "Oh, okay, I'm sorry, but I'm from the Observer newspaper." And they said, "You're in big trouble." But to go back to your question, before I got there, they'd shot 300 or 400 of these boys and kicked them in the river. And they were doing other things to them, which I can't tell you about. It was too awful. And I thought, well, I'm going to grab these pictures while I can. Otherwise, this is all going to, you know, it'll all be finished. They'll all be gone and murdered. So I did it. I took the pictures. And, it's like what went on in the death camps in Germany. If we'd have seen before, I mean, this English government at the time, I don't really believe that they believed that it was going on in Germany. So do I press the button and make out it's not going on, or do I press the button and tell you it is going on? It's a huge dilemma for me. I could have lots of fingers wagging at me about these pictures on the wall here. And I think it's up to me to accept the wagging fingers and try to say, well, I'm personally not guilty, but, you know, maybe I could be guilty. But if you exacerbate their suffering, that's where the uncomfortable side of your question comes into it. I don't thank you for asking it, but it's a good question.
This gentleman here, and then I think that's going to have to be our last question.
Thank you. I was going to ask, are there any images that you regret not taking? And conversely, are there any images which you regret having taken?
Any images that you regret taking and any images that you regret not taking?
No to both questions, but I have witnessed men being executed, and I don't really think, when you see a man standing, his legs are trembling and he's weeping and looking at you, begging you to help. I was with another Frenchman in a jungle clearing where they captured some soldiers in Nigeria during the Biafran War. And they dragged these soldiers, and a man, one of the officers, said to the commander, "What should we do with the prisoners?" He said, "Oh, kill them." And I was with a Frenchman, photographer, and he said, "Did you hear what I heard?" I said, "Yeah, it's terrible, isn't it?" He said, and then the man timidly said to the commander, "Sir, sir, what should we do?" He said, "I told you to kill them." And then they started shooting the men, and we stood there, he and I, dumbfounded, paralyzed with shame. And 3 years later, the Frenchman himself was murdered in a jungle clearing in Cambodia, but he was murdered slowly with an entrenching tool over his head by the Khmer Rouge.
Nice.
So this world we're talking about discussing tonight, it's a foggy place to be, a dark, nasty place to be. And you could ask, well, why did you stick around for so long? I'm asking my own questions now, but...
it's what you're reduced to when you're being interviewed by someone like me.
I'm trying to get in first.
I think I'm just going to end by saying that, you know, you have always been a maverick, you've always been rebellious, you've always followed exactly the path that you felt you should follow, and in a way, everyone else be damned. Are you content with that rebellious nature now manifesting itself mainly in small acts of rebellion, like standing on Hadrian's Wall, which I know is not allowed and one of your favourite things to do?
It's not allowed, actually. There's a notice saying, please keep off the wall, but I thought there's nobody around, so there was a blizzard going on. It's over there, isn't it, I think? Or is it? No, maybe not. Anyway... one thing I must say, just to clear the patch here tonight, is that it doesn't matter how nice people are about the things I have done right, I cannot wear the laurels comfortably.
I know, but I think we've got that impression.
Oh, okay.
And yeah, and I'm not surprised, but I think that you've done a very, very good job over a very long time, and we're very grateful to you for risking your neck instead of us having to do the same thing. Thank you. Don McCullin.